I see a few new faces. Let me just briefly explain what the Woodrow Wilson Center is about and the Congress Project, and then we'll get on with our program. Back in 1968, Congress enacted a law to create a living memorial to our 28th president, Woodrow Wilson, who to date is still the only president to have a PhD. And the idea of the living memorial was to bring together the two facets of Wilson's life, both a scholar, as you know, he was a professor of political science and government and history, and also a politician, governor of New York, 1910 to 1912, and then president from 1913 until 1920. But Wilson believed strongly that both the scholars and the politicians, the thinkers and the doers, would benefit by coming together and exchanging views on issues of the day. And that is the idea in which the Wilson Center is born. We have about 800 meetings a year here. Some say far too many, but we do have a lot of good interaction between people from the business community, from government, from academia, and so on. The Congress Project was begun in that same spirit back in 1999. After I ran out of scholarships as a guest scholar, they brought me on staff, and we began doing programs where we brought together either members of Congress or current or former senior staffers, along with scholars who write about Congress, or in today's instance, we have a pollster here who's going to enlighten us a bit, but also journalists who have covered Congress with newspapers or broadcast stations or whatever. And so that's how the Congress Project was born. We are now on the fifth program of a two-year series on policymaking, the media, and public opinion. As you know, today's program is on Congress deficits and public opinion, and we're going to explore whether the deficit really is emerging again as a political issue and as a growing concern in Congress. We've certainly heard some anecdotal evidence to this effect with the so-called Tea Party movement, as well as some actions on the part of both the President and the Congress expressing concern about growing deficits and debt. Whether this is approaching to a parallel of what we witnessed in 1992 with the rise of Ross Perot and his little charts on the deficit and debt, or 1994 when the Republican takeover of Congress reflected a certain concern about the deficit, is another matter that we'll probably explore a little bit with our pollster and others here. But at least we thought it was at least prominent enough an issue that we would do a program on this. 2 weeks ago, the Congressional Budget Office came out with its analysis of the President's fiscal 2011 budget. Let's look at the chart that's on their cover page of their site there. This shows in blue the President's, the lighter color here. Our color isn't too great on the document camera. But the President's projected deficits according to policies that he would like to enact alongside the CBO baseline, or the current services budget, what would happen if we didn't enact any new policies in law. So you'll see that we're up around $1.6 trillion there to begin with. It does dip down in the middle years in 2014, but then rises again in 2020. The next slide shows something that is gives you a perspective on this, and that is the deficit as a percent of the gross domestic product. You'll see starts out at 10.6% in the current fiscal year. It starts to come down and really levels off around 4% in the middle years, and then starts to rise again as a percent of GDP there. The other thing, though, that is of even more concern, I think, is looking at the debt and the debt ratio to GDP. They say that sustainability is around 60%, which is around where we are now, but anything above that, you get into real trouble. But you'll notice by 2020, they're estimating that this could get as high as 88%. I think the latest CBO actually says 90%, if I'm not mistaken. So this is a concern of both the executive branch and the Congress as to how we deal with the rising tide of deficits and debt in the coming years. We're very fortunate to have with us today an expert panel. I will say, not to diminish in any way the quality of the people that are on the panel, but we did attempt to get some members of Congress, but for some reason they're tied up today, and I just don't understand what that is. There's a little thing called the Budget Committee markup of the reconciliation bill today, and as you know, they're also scrambling up there to put together the final pieces on that bill, so we'll see how that comes out by the end of the week. if it does come out at the end of the week. But we, what I thought we would do is start out with our guest pollster, a person that works for the Pew Research Center, Carol Daugherty, who has also worked previously with the Congressional Quarterly, a very respected journal, as you know, in town, and he covered the Hill for many years with that. But since leaving there, he's been with Pew, but he's also been an analyst on a lot of the networks on elections and polls and so on. But we're just very pleased to have him here to sort of open things up and look at where the public has been on deficits over time and the debt issue as well. We're then going to go to Scott Lilly, who is now a senior fellow at the Center for American Progress. Scott, though, for over three decades, was a very familiar person on Capitol Hill. He culminated his career as the staff director for the House Appropriations Committee under David Obey. He previously worked as executive director of the Democratic Study Group and executive director of the Joint Committee on Economic, what's it called?
Joint Economic Committee,
right. And was also Dave Obey's administrative assistant, I think, when he first entered the Hill. The our third panelist will be Bill Hoagland, who was a senior, who is a public vice president for public policy at Cigna now, but for over three decades was primarily on the Senate side with Pete Domenici on the Budget Committee as his staff director there. He had been Pete Domenici's chief of staff at one point, and he ended up as the top budget aide with Bill Frist when he was majority leader. So Bill has a vast amount of experience on the Hill as well. But he got his start in Washington with the Congressional Budget Office when it was just a little baby, I think. And then he went for a while down to the Department of Agriculture. So he's seen the budget and government working from a number of different angles. So we're very pleased to have Bill back here. This is a return visit for Bill. And then I always like to keep our journalists as the wrap-up, the cleanup hitters, because they usually do bring things together for us and after hearing a bunch of things, but they're the ones that sort of wear out the shoe leather on Capitol Hill and getting the real story behind the scenes as to what the games have been played in the past, how they compare to what's going on now. But Eric Pianin was a longtime reporter, congressional correspondent for The Washington Post. He wrote a book along with George Hager in its second edition. It was called Balancing Act, Washington's Troubled Path to a Balanced Budget. But I think in its first incarnation, this is before they actually achieved a balanced budget, it had another title. It was called Mirage, Why Neither Democrats Nor Republicans Can Balance the Budget in the Deficit and Satisfy the Public.
Should have stayed with that.
But lo and behold, yeah, I think it's probably is worth a new edition right now. But in any event, what happened in the interim between the first and second edition, of course, was the dot-com boom and some of the things that Bill Clinton put into effect through his reconciliation bill and so on. So in the late 90s, there actually was a surplus for a few years there, and I think one of your charts reflects that brief four-year hiatus of real surpluses, but then we were back in the tubs again with the turndown in the economy and a couple of wars and a few other things. But with that, I'll introduce Carol Daugherty as our opening presenter on the public and the deficit. Carol?
Thanks, Don. I am associate director with the Pew Research Center for the People and the Press. We're a nonpartisan, nonprofit public opinion research firm and center in Washington. I'd like to give you just because of the confusion about the Pew name in Washington, I always do this. I wanted to give you a little 10-second organizational perimeter. We are on the research side of the Pew Research Center empire here in Washington. There is, as you know, an advocacy side on issues like global warming, the environment, civic life, etc. We are firmly on the research side, though. We do our own polls. We analyze other people's polls, and I think in some ways we're uniquely positioned to talk about subjects like this. We're not associated with any media organization, which gives us an advantage in some ways. We also can ask questions about the media, among other things. When I looked back over 30 years of public opinion polling, going all the way back to the 1980s, you find some fascinating things. This opening slide just gives you the bullet points. I think overall, often throughout the 80s and 90s, we see our basic measure of what the public cares about is an open-ended question, just saying, what's the most important problem facing the United States? And many times during the 80s and 90s, we saw the budget deficit, the excessive spending that volunteered as a problem. It was ranked among the top national problems in the 80s and 90s. Clearly, I think in that era and even today, the public gets it about the seriousness of deficits. They don't always get it about why deficits matter, the economic or fiscal implications, the long term. They get that it matters in part because most Americans have to balance their own budget at the end of the month, and for that reason alone, a lot of Americans get it when it comes to the deficit. On the other hand, it has long remained, I think Bob Shrum said this in the Politico the other day, as an abstract issue. It always seems to come in second to sort of more pressing concerns. For instance, today, jobs, unemployment, that's the dominant issue. That's the issue that bothers most Americans, that they're most concerned about. The deficit's rising rapidly, but jobs are still number one. And then, as I think Eric knows throughout his writing the book, that there's little willingness among the public or lawmakers typically to sacrifice, whether that be in the form of tax increases or deep budget cuts to do anything about the deficit. And I think we've seen a consistent pattern in the public opinion over the years. So let's look back at some of this data. I was struck by one of the quotes from Ron Suskind's book about Paul O'Neill that seems to be making the rounds recently about Dick Cheney supposedly saying that Reagan proved that deficits don't matter. I went back and looked at Suskind's book about O'Neill, and I thought he might be talking in fiscal terms. It's possible he might meant it politically. And I think, at least as far as Reagan was concerned, Cheney might have been right. because, I mean, here's a little snapshot of where things stood as we were heading into the 1984 campaign. And you can see there that the concern about the deficit, the budget deficit at that time, was rising rapidly. You see a tripling of the percentage saying it was the most important problem, government spending and deficits, between November of 83 and August of 84. It's pretty clear as to why the Democrats would want to make this an issue in Reagan's reelection campaign. I mean, you see it ranking. These are the top issues in August 84. You know, at that time, the recovery was well underway. The unemployment numbers not terribly favorable, but they were coming down. There was a deep concern in public opinion polling at that time that the deficit would threaten the recovery, actually. 60% said that in that August 84 poll. And you can see Reagan's own vulnerability on the issue. This was Reagan approval Gallup survey from March of 84. Overall job rating 54%, economy 49%, not bad. Relations with USSR, which was still in existence at the time, 43%. 29% on Lebanon. You might recall in 1983 the attack on the Marine barracks in 1983, so Reagan got fairly low marks there. But among all the issues polled, the deficit was his worst issue, significantly worse than any other issue. And you can see that really hurt him in the 1984 election, since he only won 49 states. So it really didn't track as well as the Democrats might have hoped. So let's jump ahead to, since this is the 30 years of history in 5 minutes, the early 90s, again, the deficit, a major concern in Bush's first couple of years. That's the 90 midterm we're heading into in July 1990. Even topping Bush's signature issue, which was drug abuse at the time, this was a major issue. And, of course, that was the period of Read My Lips, No New Taxes, and the 1990 budget deal, where Bush, to his political detriment at least, when it broke that promise, and that was immediately, there was immediately a public reaction against that, a majority disapproval of Bush's decision to agree to raise taxes at that time in the 90 period. By 92, if we're in that, when we're in the heat of the presidential election campaign of 92, the deficit's kind of fallen a little bit. We see the economy, we're back, we're in a recession now, and the recession, jobless numbers rising, you can see how the it's just the economic pain that people are feeling is rising on the list of the most important problems. You know, a quadrupling in the unemployment number going from, concern about unemployment going from 3% to 27%. But then you get to the closing days of the 92 campaign, and you see this phenomenon that Don mentioned, the Perot phenomenon. I'm not sure we all remember exactly what an influence he was in terms of raising the profile of this issue, you know, through infomercial and his charts, as Don said. This is just a snapshot of what happened after the final debate in 1992. You know, he already was ahead of Clinton and Bush on the deficit. Look at how he soared after that final debate. I mean, people thought he won that debate. I found a very interesting factoid from one of our polls in 1992 that 79% of those who agreed with said they agreed with Perot's ideas, but just couldn't vote for him, and that's why he ended up with 19% of the vote on election day. Not bad for a third party, but still far behind. We jump ahead to the budget agreement. You know, this was a time, as I look back in this period, this 96-97 period, there were a lot of legislative accomplishments at that time. This is coming right after welfare reform. The Kennedy-Kassebaum health insurance portability bill, which was very popular at the time. Yet, of all those issues, 74%, more than any other issue, said that the balanced budget agreement was very important for the country. And of all the issues we polled at that time, including, this is family and medical leave, some of the accomplishments from the Clinton era, 34% said it was most important for them personally. Now, why they said that? They had a variety of answers, but they felt like this would forestall any possible tax increases. That was the leading answer at the time. So they did make the connection then. We're going to jump way ahead in history to the current period. And you can see the deficit is making a comeback, even in this era of when, you know, 10% unemployment. The percentage citing the deficit, debt or spending, as the most important problem has almost doubled on a volunteered basis since last August to February. That's the highest percentage we've seen since 1993 expressing that as a most important problem. Through much of the Bush era, it never hit 10%. And so we're seeing it's back on the radar. It's back on the public's radar pretty firmly. But jobs are issue. Oh, there we go. But jobs are still the dominant issue. It's hard to overstate the importance of jobs. Three times as many cite jobs as the deficit or debt as major problems. And this has had the effect of leading to a conflicted public opinion. When you ask the question, what's more important right now? Spending more to keep the economic recovery going or to create the economic recovery or cutting the deficit, you get about an even split of opinion on it. And when you get to specific budget cuts, very little appetite at this point, and no polling organization has even asked questions recently about the possibility of cuts in Social Security or Medicare. This is the question that we asked in February. What's a higher priority for government now? To spend more for recovery, the economic recovery, or to reduce the budget deficit. There's your even split. And what you see there is that among independents and Democrats, even independents who are you know, said to be more budget deficit conscious right now than they have been in the past, you get a majority of independents saying spend more for recovery, that should be the bigger priority right now. And this is a New York Times CBS question. What are you willing to decrease spending on to reduce the deficit? So, you know, Democrats very unwilling to decrease spending on health care or education. But look at the Republican number there in the middle, 47% willing to decrease spending on health care education. 55% of Democrats willing to decrease spending on the military. But still, that if you look across those two questions, there's very little support overall for making reductions in those programs. And again, this is setting aside the issue of Social Security or Medicare. This is what deficits are doing right now. This is sort of gives you a backdrop of where we stand today at, you know, on the 2010 election with about 6 months to go or so. You know, the deficits clearly are plunging apart, I think, in some of this anti-government cynicism we see. Partly it's the idea that Democrats and Republicans can't get along and get anything done, but this extraordinary anti-Washington sentiment here and an anti-incumbent sentiment. 32% want most incumbents reelected, 49%. Just 49% want their own member reelected. And here's a backdrop of how it's played in the midterms past, the key years being 94 and 2006, when the 94 the Republicans took over in the famous Contract with America election, and 2006 when the Democrats took back the Congress. You know, it's interesting, in the summer of 94, what a big issue crime was. I think we all forget just how big an issue it was. 5% saw the deficit as the top problem. That's not a terribly low number. It was among the top tier issues that campaign. The Republicans had a lead on that issue of 42% to 32%, 36% is the party better able to handle. And it played a role. There's no doubt it played a role in the Republicans' victory that year. I don't think it was the number one or the leading issue, but certainly I think it contributed. The September 2006, that's the Bush administration. At that time, the war in Iraq, a big negative for Republicans, obviously. Just 1% at that time saw the deficit as a top problem. Democrats had a big lead on virtually every issue outside of terrorism and national security in that election, in that campaign. 20-point issue on the deficit. Jump ahead to February 2010, jobs the number one issue, 11% citing the deficit. It's interesting and I think a little scary for Democrats, perhaps, that Republicans hold an identical lead as the party better able to handle the deficit as they did in July of 94. I don't know whether that serves as an omen or not, but it is interesting. The Republicans now lead, aside from terrorism, this is the only major issue on which they lead. They are running about even on the economy, which I think is pretty interesting. But what this gets to, the other issue, the other area, the other key area where they're running about even with the Democrats, is the party better able to manage the federal government. And I think this idea of deficits is undermining the Democrats on that particular issue. And I think I'll leave it there. This is our websites, People-Press is where I work, and Pew Research, General Pew Research website, and we'll move it on from there.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Scott, you may use the podium, or, oh, that's right, you got to use the PowerPoint, too. So.
Let me see if I can. Richard, can you help him get to the sailboat?
Okay. Thank you very much. I'm going to talk about this more in terms of the way I see it substantively than politically, which I think will become apparent. But I think it's important to lay back a lot of the rhetoric that we go through and look at what it really takes, what is the problem and what it takes to solve it. First issue I think is how big are the deficits that we have now? How do they compare with ones we've had in the past? If you look. At any rate, the one this year's deficit's 10.6% of GDP. That makes it about the fifth biggest deficit in the last 70 years. but much, much smaller than deficits we had in the 1940s during World War II. And last year's deficit was just a little smaller than that. And the deficits in the out years are smaller still, with the 2012 actually smaller than the deficit we had in 1985. The big question, though, is sort of how do cumulative deficits affect the country? Don showed in a slide earlier what was happening in terms of the public debt as a percentage of GDP, and the 2010 deficit is got us at 64% of at the end of 2010 we will be at 64% of GDP in terms of public debt, and that's that's pretty substantial. I'd point out that's not as much as most of our trading partners have. They're in the 70-80%. Belgium's above 90, and this was in 2007. They're not recent data, but I'm sure all of those countries have gone up. Germany, Canada, and most of Europe are probably now in the 90 percentiles. Japan is over 180%. So it's not by international standards that bad. I'm sorry. And this gives you that those numbers from 2007. We were only at 37%, so you can see we've already jumped very substantially in 3 years. The problem is not the deficits that we have now, not the level of public debt that we have now. As you can see, in 1946, public debt was 108% of GDP. The real problem is that we had a huge decline after that. We were able to, even though we didn't balance the budget most years, our deficits were a relatively small share of GDP, and we had substantial growth. So year after year, we whittled down debt as a percentage of GDP, even though debt grew over that period. And that's actually a pretty healthy scenario. By 1974, incidentally, the year that we passed the Budget Act, we had cut our public debt to 23.9% of GDP. That's very healthy. God could grant us that low of a debt today. And you can see from 109%, that's just a blow up of the earlier chart going from 46 to 74. But that's not the situation we face today, and that's what the real problem is. And it really does not have, I think there's a great deal of confusion of this, it doesn't have a whole lot to do with the current recession, although it contributes to the problem. It has very little to do with the a recovery package, or the stimulus package, as it's called. What it has to do with is the fact that people that were born in 1946, the first wave of the baby boomers, will turn 65 in fiscal 2011. And every year after that, more and more baby boomers will turn 65, and that is driving entitlements through the roof. Social Security is going to go up exponentially, and it's going to stop contributing to or offsetting the deficits in the rest of the budget and start contributing to the deficits as Medicare and Medicaid are increasing very rapidly. This is from the brief. I did this. I just wanted to tweak down a little bit. But I also think it's a very good point. What happened in the 1990s that caused us to go from very big surplus or very big deficits to large surpluses? And I think this is something a lot of people can talk about. I don't think the dot-com had much to do with it. I think the 97 budget deal, most of which was repealed the following year when they found out they didn't need it, but very little of it went into effect and contributed. I don't think either of those played much of a role. As you can see, we went from about $320 billion deficits to about $230 billion surpluses in a period of 8 years. What was different about those 8 years? Tremendous economic growth, and it wasn't just dot-com, it was across the economy. And if you compare it to the 8 years earlier, the 8 years after, you can see it was a 50% higher rate of growth than the previous 8 years, and even more than that with the, compared to the subsequent 8 years. Employment, absolutely through the roof, 83% more jobs created during those 8 years than the previous 8 years, and 360% more jobs compared to the subsequent 8 years. So strong economy, increased revenues, that had a lot to do with it, but Congress also increased revenues. The 1993 budget deal was the much reviled $240 billion tax increase. It calmed inflation fears, it helped bring down long-term interest rates, it really set a very strong base for the things that happened in 94-95 and they led to the previous two charts. By 2000, we were collecting 20.6% of GDP in federal revenues. There were a lot of people that said, as they will now, that that was not going to work. And Dick Armey said, it's clearly, he said of the 93 bill, it's clearly a job killer in the short run, the impact on job creation is going to be devastating. That was the 20 million jobs that he was saying weren't going to be created. The tax increase will lead to a recession, said Newt Gingrich. We will have a deficit in 4 years. But instead, we didn't have a deficit. We had we were able to start paying down the public debt. This is a chart that shows you what portion of GDP we were collecting in revenues during that period. We went from 17.5% up to 20.6%, and then in the passage that was just cited from Secretary Treasury's book of Vice President Cheney saying deficits don't matter, it was in the context of discussing the tax cuts that brought revenues down to 16% of GDP. Had we kept the 17.5% of GDP, which we had in 1993, as the portion of GDP that we collected, we would not have had a balanced budget in 2000 or in 1998 or 99. Had we remained at that level of taxation, we would have had surpluses every year up until 2008. So revenues played a huge role in that. Had we maintained that level of taxation, we would have had a public debt that was about $3 trillion smaller, and we would be paying $100 million a year less in interest on the debt, which is, I should have used my slide instead of going through that myself. But the final point is if we maintained taxes at 20.6%, which did not seem to do huge harm in the late latter part of the last decade, we could stabilize debt in this country. We're not going to really start paying it down unless we either take taxes above that level or make more substantial moves on entitlements than we had. But my point here is that revenues have to be on the table. I think national security spending in the Obama budget is unrealistically low. It assumes that the conflicts in Iraq and Afghanistan are going to conclude and that we're not going to have any further problems of that type. I think history tells us that we probably will. I think, is very unrealistic in terms of non-defense discretionary, which it freezes non-defense discretionary for 2 years and then maintains that freeze level with no more than a cost of living adjustment through that. During that period, the population of the United States will increase by 30 million people, or 10%. And that puts stress on every agency in the federal government. You can't have the same number of air traffic controllers in a country that's going to have about 30% more takeoffs and landings 10 years from now. And the same goes for one agency after another. They're just simply going to have a much higher workload, and they're going to have to pay for the costs of maintaining their workforce and all of those things. And I think what happened on the health care bill, where a proposal which I think would have brought the cost of Medicare down over a period of time without cutting benefits, simply by trying to squeeze provider costs, was met with such derision by the people who supposedly don't want any tax increases and want to take it out of spending, really is an indication of how hard it's going to be to do anything on entitlements. If we can't make those kinds of changes in the Medicare program, which is the one that's really eating us alive in terms of budget deficits, then I think we're going to have to do a lot more on revenues than what I've just laid out. Thank you, sir.
All right, Bill Hoagland.
I don't have a PowerPoint, so I'll sit right here and give you my. I want to begin by picking up on a theme that was in Don's paper, talking about tides and seas of red ink. In the short space of the last year, I've worked on two studies with the threatening titles of Red Ink Rising and Drowning in Red Ink, and I concluded that the challenges I think we all acknowledge that elected officials are faced in trying to part the Red Sea are there, they're real. But of course, we also know that that act was accomplished in Exodus by a mortal who had significant help from a higher authority. And so since Don asked how Congress, I think, will deal with this issue, and since I will probably conclude here that it will take a much higher authority than the U.S. Congress to find a solution, you can appreciate my somewhat surprise and yet elation last week when the liberal Ninth Circuit Court in California ruled that the phrase, "In God We Trust," was okay. First of all, let me be very clear. I work with some of those Republicans that have been mentioned here. I am one of those who think deficits do matter. To my friends who do the polling, let me just say that we can poll the American public until we're blue in the face. I think the truth of the matter is that anyone who says you cannot have it both ways clearly has not been spending much time reading those polls, because we want Washington and the states to fix our problems now, and at the same time we want government to shrink, spend less, and reduce our taxes. We dislike government in the abstract. We love it in the particular. When I review the New York CBS poll, very similar, Carol, to where you were coming out, when it considered what was the most important issue, deficits didn't show up as high as yours. They were closer to 4%, but yes, consistent jobs and the economy were well above that. But I think no need to belabor this. This group here can understand completely how the three are inextricably linked. But convincing the American public, let alone the elected officials, that our fiscal fault lines are widening, and unless they address this quickly, the public's current concerns over our jobs and our economy will pale by comparison from my perspective. I don't think this should come as any big surprise. Behavioral scientists we know tell you that human beings will always focus on the current issue and heavily discount the future. We live in a time of instant gratification made politically more challenging by congressional elections held every 2 years. I'll come back to this on a different approach than what Scott had taken in just a minute. Just a couple of facts that are really bothering me. I'm not going to go through a lot of this. Has already been covered in some of the presentations, but just a couple of facts to refresh everybody's memory of why things are really scary to me today. In the month of February alone, the federal government ran the largest ever monthly deficit ever recorded, $221 billion in 1 month. That's a figure that's equivalent to the deficit in the whole year of 2006. In the first 6 months of this year, we've run a deficit of about $650 billion, 10.5% higher than it was last year. And, of course, as we've already discussed, we're on track here to hit a deficit of possibly $1.5 trillion this year based on the administration's own estimates. Second, early last month, Moody's Investors Service warned that the U.S. AAA sovereign credit rating would come under pressure unless economic growth was more robust than expected or tougher actions were taken to tackle the country's budget deficit. And then just last week, Standard & Poor's issued a report that stated flatly the U.S. cannot take the dollar's role for granted. Once again, this rating agency concluded that unless the U.S. addresses the fiscal deficit and debt, foreign investors could start to reduce their dollar holdings, sending rates sharply higher and undermining the economy, which in turn could jeopardize the AAA rating. John Chambers, who is the chairman of the S&P Sovereign Rating Committee, said that the president's 2010 budget was disappointing, and the will is not yet there. But optimistically, he concluded that a, quote, a more robust fiscal consolidation plan will emerge after this year's midterm congressional elections. I've heard that before. Fourth, I think we've already discussed the president's budget. Don went through some of the numbers. At 90% of GDP in terms of debt held by the public, which doesn't even take into consideration the unfunded liabilities of those other big trust funds out there. But that's out there in the future. Let's just look at where we are right now at 63%. I don't disagree with Scott's figures. But quite frankly, we couldn't even qualify for the euro today if we at 63%. And in just 4 or 5 years, we'll be seeing debt-to-GDP figures where Greece is basically today. And I think we all know where Prime Minister Papandreou, what he's been going through to try to bring his country's finances back into some semblance of balance. And I don't necessarily agree with Neil Ferguson, who recently claimed the U.S. will face its own Greek crisis. We are not Greece. On the one hand, we don't have European Union to back us up. But I think we are indeed walking on a very, very thin tightrope. And finally, one last factoid. It's that last chart in that I presented to you, which just kind of struck me. Last Thursday, the Federal Reserve issued its flow of funds data through the last quarter of 2009. And the last chart in that packet there shows you, displays graphically, that on net, unbelievably, on net, the only sector in our economy borrowing money last quarter on net was federal, state, and local governments. And the income-producing sectors in terms of businesses and households reduced their borrowing. And while there may be some good coming out of that as it relates to over-leveraged consumers, over time that's unsustainable if we are expected as to ever to get back to growth. So what will the president will Congress do? First of all, I just, my friends that I worked across the aisle from, I just would remind them, do you remember the much-touted Federal Fiscal Responsibility Summit held a year ago at the White House and designed to focus on the growth of entitlements? And 4 days later, the president presents a budget that not only doesn't address entitlements but expands entitlements. So far, in fairness to the president, he's put for two budgets he has submitted, none of them make any recommendations or suggestions on modernizing our Social Security system or recommending any fundamental changes to our discombobulated tax code. But courageously, and I agree with Scott on this, courageously he has proposed to freeze for 3 years non-security discretionary spending, which is really not the problem in the federal budget. Maybe that's a start, but in the midst of this, and I'm not wearing a Cigna hat at this moment, but in the midst of this, with these dire forecasts, we are likely to see later this week the biggest expansion of entitlement spending in decades with the enactment of the health care legislation, a legislation that I, in my opinion, will take off the table an opportunity to address deficit reduction by reducing the rapid growth of Medicare and Medicaid in the future. Joe and I are on a panel, and hopefully I think one of the issues as budget geeks continue to look at in terms of one way to get a handle on our deficit is reducing Medicare and Medicaid, but quite frankly, maybe we've reduced it in this bill, but we've created another major entitlement. So unable to put forward a budget that would achieve his stated goal of stabilizing debt to GDP in the midst of expanding federal health care spending, the president proposes to establish what? A National Commission on Fiscal Responsibility and Reform to make, again, recommendations that may or may not be considered in a lame duck session. If you sense that I'm a little frustrated, you bet I am. The bipartisanship that I grew up with early and Scott and I worked on many, many years ago, it just isn't there. The fact that the leading solution to addressing our fiscal future in this country has evolved into contracting out the legislative responsibilities to a commission with three non-elected officials and some congressional members who are not even running for election this fall dramatizes to me the level at which legislative gridlock on this subject has gripped the halls of Congress. Sadly, it suggests to me that the political process is incapable of informing and reforming its fiscal situation until a crisis dictates immediate action. Personally, I thought we had that crisis in 2008, and I would have thought it would have focused our attention. I recognize the need for stimulus in a time of a recession, but nothing really, I sense, came out of this crisis, and so that led me recently to make an offhanded comment that got me in trouble when I said I wondered if this country is even governable anymore on this subject. But then I was pulled out by supported in some ways, not that I like to quote him too much, but David Stockman wrote last month that, quote, a fiscal doomsday looks certain because the actions required to avoid it are beyond the capability of our ungovernable fiscal process. Stockman estimated, by the way, that what was needed at a minimum, was a structural change in the budget deficit equal to 5% of GDP. That translates into $700 billion annually. Just to put into perspective the much maligned 1997 balanced budget agreement, we estimated we would save $425 billion over 10 years. So just put it in perspective. So overcoming and unwinding the increasing polarization that has come to dominate the U.S. Congress, I think, is a key to achieving the necessary conditions for fiscal reform. Polarization, as Don has studied so well here, I think is at the highest, from what I can understand from the academics, it's as high as it's been in 120 years. But when you ask the American public out there their views, you tend to get the overwhelming proportion of Americans consider themselves to be moderate versus liberal at 19% versus conservative at 38%. So as political parties have become more extreme relative to the voters, barriers are constructed to reaching consensus or compromise on major public policy issues. Result, the average citizen, from my perspective, becomes distrustful, frustrated, and withdraws from the process, with the result remaining that the participants who do participate are even more ideological and partisan. It's not the purpose of this panel to engage in a discourse on the factors that have led to polarization. Those who I study or review generally have concluded, however, the factors are growing income inequality, immigration, technology. I would put my money on a little bit of this next one, unchecked media expansion and the interconnection of increasing campaign costs and lobby campaigns. It's been observed by some that most Americans will sacrifice for the larger public good, but few will sacrifice for a competing group, and competing groups have multiplied in an interconnected wireless society. Coalitions from extremes of the political spectrum form, and they feed the gridlock, from MoveOn.org on the left to Club the Growth on the right. And finally, as governments has grown, programs take on the life of their own, supported by narrowly focused interest groups and constituents supporting a specific program, buttressed by modern technological tools of instant communications through the Internet, Twitter, Facebook, and other social networking tools. What exists tends to survive. So parting the Red Sea. Given the barriers to reform, can coalitions be formed to part the Red Sea and address it? It's not clear to me, but I'm not optimistic. History would say that the major congressional reforms demand bipartisan support, and history has shown it can be achieved under some unique situations. John Hilly and I, who worked, and Joe and others, on 1997 to try to get close to a balanced budget, wrote in his book that the nation's leaders reached across the aisle and pulled together, forging an agreement that served the national interest, and for a brief shining moment, bipartisanship had fulfilled its promise in the triumph of responsibility. That achievement came only after very bitter partisan fights in the Gingrich-Clinton years, leading to the longest period of government shutdown ever recorded. In other words, it took a crisis to force responsible action. I wish it should not be that way. Pat Monahan, before he retired, issued a warning: never pass major legislation that affects most Americans without real bipartisan support. It opens up all kinds of political trouble. So the 111th Congress began the year by passing an economic stimulus package with zero Republican support in the House and three GOP senators in the Senate, and one of those which then quickly changed party. The House passed a health care reform bill similarly with only one House Republican supporting it, and he now said that he will not support the final bill. And, of course, we know that the Senate passed its health care bill on Christmas Eve with no Republican support. So it appears the 111th Congress is likely its two major accomplishments will have been enacted with no Republican support. Without any sign today of decreasing partisanship or polarization in the Congress, short of a rise in a strong third-party challenge to the current institutionalized two-party structure, or short of a Senate clearly dominated by one party or the other, well in excess of 60 members, or short of some major cataclysmic economic meltdown, it's difficult for me to be sanguine about the political process finding a path through the Red Sea. And so thank goodness to the Ninth Circuit to let us keep our motto, "In God We Trust."
Thank you, Bill. I think I probably forgot to mention in referring to Eric Pianin that he is currently the Washington editor of a new online publication called The Fiscal Times, and he helped to clarify for me that this is funded by Peter G. Peterson, but not his foundation. But I asked him to talk a little bit about both the traditional media and the new media and how they have covered the deficit in the past, what changes he's seeing going on now, and really how it covers other aspects of government as well. But, Eric, the floor is yours.
Thank you. Thanks, Don. I was asked to back cleanup, and this is really the easiest part of the program because it's virtually impossible to follow someone like Bill Hoagland or Scott Lilly or Carol Doherty and have much more to add to the discussion. I think I was asked to take part in the program because I'm one of those journalists who has made the transition from the old media to the new media, and that was a journey that took me from Washington Post budget and economics reporter on Capitol Hill throughout the Clinton administration to congressional editor for the Post and politics editor at WashingtonPost.com. And then more recently, I worked for a while at yet another online startup, Kaiser Health News, covering Congress for them, and then moving on to my present job as Washington editor of the Fiscal Times, which is a digital news service focusing on budget and economic issues. I'll have to say that while I've had many different reporting and editing jobs for the Post and other papers and publications throughout my career, there are few assignments more challenging, interesting, and consequential than grappling with the budget deficit and reporting on, you know, mounting concerns about the deficit and entitlements and, you know, basically dealing both with the intellectual challenge of figuring out, you know, all these complicated issues and baselines, but also kind of steeping yourself in the rich history and legislative lore and the political battles of the budget going back to, you know, the Reagan and Johnson years. And what really fascinated me, you know, most was sort of those backstories and you know, Reagan and Tip O'Neill, you know, fighting over you know, tax cuts and Pete Domenici and David Stockman, you know, going at each other and trying to decide what a suitable budget would be, or dealing with people like Charlie Stenholm and Leon Panetta. These were all great, interesting characters, and it sort of made the whole process of covering the budget very exciting. And it also was the inspiration for the book that George Hager and I did on the budget wars, you know, throughout the Clinton administration. And, you know, I'll never forget sitting in the House press gallery one night back in August 1993, watching an ashen-faced freshman Democrat named Marjorie Margolis-Bizvinsky being led to the floor by Democratic leadership and persuaded to cast the deciding vote to pass President Clinton's package of unpopular spending cuts and tax increases. And then as she cast the decisive vote in favor of it, Republicans on the floor hooting something like "Goodbye, Marjorie" to her, and you're a goner. And sure enough, a year later, she was indeed gone, and she was swept out with dozens of other House Democrats as the Republicans took control of the House and the Senate. It sounds a little familiar. I mean, I think, you know, when I think about the ongoing debate on health care reform and the polarization and bitterness and political manipulating going on, maneuvering going on the floor right now, I mean, it's sort of a throwback to that period. Although, as Bill Hoagland said, there's a feeling that the partisan divide is even greater than back then, which is kind of hard to imagine, but I think that's true. It's also interesting just to listen to Bill and Scott, you know, talk about the deficit and deficit projections, and there's an element of doom and gloom to all that. But the reality is there's a raging debate going on in Washington and throughout the country, really, on economics and the budget deficit. And the debate is essentially, should we be worrying about the deficit that much, given the tough economic times we're in, or should we be focusing more on creating more jobs and getting the economy going and then worrying about the deficit down the road? You know, what is the magic number we could be most comfortable with in terms of debt to GDP or whatever measurement you want, a meaningful measurement you want of the impact of the deficit on the economy and our budget and our future? And, you know, there's sort of a counter argument out there that, you know, deficits, they matter, but they don't matter that much. And maybe we can live with these for a while. But what's interesting is that, you know, when I was covering the budget intensely, you know, back during the Clinton administration, you know, a lot of the talk was about stuff that was out there in the murky future. It's sort of like, well, the changing demographics, society is getting older. There'll be, you know, gradually there'll be more and more baby boomers retiring, fewer and fewer workers to generate the revenues to sustain those Social Security payments and all that. But, you know, that was 20 years ago or so. And now, you know, we're actually confronting all of those things. In a sense, we don't have that much time anymore to deal with some of these critical issues, including somehow trying to get control of the unsustainable growth in healthcare costs. And that's an issue that the president was very concerned about going into healthcare reform. And there was a lot of talk about trying to do something about bending the cost curve. But at least based on CBO analysis, so far there's nothing in that that package that really achieves those goals that the president has been talking about. Maybe some of these pilot projects in the healthcare bill will pan out, and maybe we'll see some of those savings. But right now, there's no indication that it really can slow the rate of growth of healthcare, which is really the major budget driver in this discussion. When I first began covering, you know, the budget and tax issues, major newspapers, including the Washington Post, the New York Times, Wall Street Journal, LA Times, were dominant, and they provided the grist for coverage by TV and radio and others. And they devoted enormous amounts of space and prominence to the budget, economics and entitlement issues. And they follow the budget process, you know, incrementally. I mean, there was a time when, you know, you could get on the front page of the Washington Post or on the cover of CQ or whatever with some incremental story about where the budget process stood. It was the hot issue of the time. And I think Carol's review of polling, you know, back in the 80s and 90s is instructive because concern about the deficit, you know, ranked among the public's top concerns. And I think it was reflected in the news coverage as well. But after, you know, obsessing about the issue in the 90s, you know, we had budget surpluses in 1998 to 2001. And then, you know, the Bush administration came along and Dick Cheney and others were saying the deficits don't matter, really. We were into a war and, we had to pay for it. And suddenly pay-as-you-go was was irrelevant to what they were trying to do. And in terms of entitlement spending, the one big thing they did was approve an entitlement that, in effect, made the problem worse by creating a large, almost completely unfunded prescription drug program in Medicare. To some extent, we all covered the budget in the 90s because, you know, Clinton and Gingrich and Bob Dole made it a priority. President Bush never did. And the budget deficit and need for entitlement reform wasn't a big issue in the 2008 campaign, or certainly nothing approaching the time when a presidential candidate like Ross Perot could draw, 10 to 20% of the primary vote by making deficits and debt, his signature issue. Nor did the issue get much attention in the first year of the Obama administration. And why would it? Health care reform commanded all the news hole that wasn't already devoted to the war in Afghanistan, the recession, stimulus, jobs bills, and financial regulatory reform. That's a lot of big issues competing for readers' attentions and reporters' energies. And right now, for better or worse, the budget's a second-tier or third-tier issue, although I think that's changing. And we're seeing this now with the president's appointment of an 18-member commission to look at what can be done, if anything, to slow the rate of growth of entitlements and possibly do something about taxes. But frankly, given the makeup of that commission as we see it now, the notion of Republicans signing off on tax increases, I don't think it's going to happen. But we'll see. Weren't you saying miracles can happen, the seek in part? I don't know. It's not as if the more traditional news media isn't paying attention to it. And then there's just some gifted newspaper reporters like Jackie Collins and Laurie Montgomery and Robert Pear who are all, covering these topics. It's just that the mainstream media no longer has the resources and space to provide the exhaustive coverage that once was afforded these topics. And, the decline in traditional newspapers and TV coverage of the budget has coincided with a substantial increase in news analysis and commentary on budget issues on the internet and cable TV. And there, as you well know, there are, literally dozens of news websites, blogs, aggregated sites that provide extensive coverage of health care reform and other budget issues. And they range from sites of more traditional publications like the Wall Street Journal and Washington Post and New York Times and Financial Times to webbier publications like Slate and Politico and Real Clear Politics and now the Fiscal Times and scads of blogs with very strong political or ideological perspectives. In fact, our friend Stan Collender not too long ago launched his own blog, Capital Gains and Games, that keeps a close tab on the budget. And Kaiser Health News launched 6 months ago focusing on healthcare reform. In some ways, if you think about it, the internet is really a much superior venue for analyzing the budget and discussing it because of all the interactive graphics and charts and links to important legislation and research and reports, it's really a fabulous tool for people trying to understand what's going on. But I think that one of the problems is that there isn't a lot of what I consider to be the traditional gumshoe, hard-hitting reporting on the budget to provide the bedrock, the basis for a lot of the commentary that we're seeing. And I noticed a couple of things caught my attention in yet another Pew Center survey that came out today. This was the Pew Research Center's Project for Excellence in Journalism survey. And a couple of things that I thought were very interesting, I thought I would just mention now. While the newspaper industry has lost $1.6 billion in annual reporting and editing capacity since the year 2000, or roughly 30%, the idea that news media is shrinking is wrong. There's an increase in commentary, analysis, and discussion, but again, that commentary relies on an iron core of reportorial journalism that is sort of on the endangered species list. In other words, we've got less and less credible reporting about important budget and economic issues, but we have more and more people commenting on that shrinking core of reporting. Also, 71% of Americans feel now that most news sources are biased in their coverage, and 70% feel overwhelmed rather than informed by the amount of news and information they see. So, it sort of outlines or sums up sort of a dilemma and a challenge for the new media, which is that there is a huge opportunity, really, for new forms of journalism and new reporting in this area. But the danger is that unless these new startups and news organizations are willing to invest the resources in doing the basic reporting and being fair-minded in their approach, the public is going to likely be more and more turned off by what they're seeing and maybe overwhelmed by a cacophony of ideological rifts and analysis, but with very little useful information to help them make these very important decisions. So in summary, I'm very honored to be here with this august group of budget experts and longtime friends. And I just want to say that as we launch the Fiscal Times, we're very mindful of some of these trends and dilemmas, and we're going to be trying as best we can with a staff of veteran budget reporters, people who've been around for a long time covering this subject on the Hill, and also drawing on experts like Scott Lilly to do commentary. We're hoping that we can give a balanced, fair view of the terrain. Thank you.
Thank you.
Let me take the prerogative of the chair before we open up to the audience for questions and just ask you all briefly what type of crisis, if we agree with Bill on this, will it take to really bring the public around to supporting some kind of a reasonable approach to dealing with the debt and deficits? Do any of you have any ideas on what that might be?
Anybody? Well, I sort of feel like Bill and I could sit down and work this out in a couple of days, even though. But I think we don't live in that kind of world anymore, and I think there is a serious change in our body politic. But I really do think, Bill and I may disagree on this. I think there's been the change has not been symmetrical. And yet the tendency is to say it's symmetrical. Everybody wants to be credible. And the best way to be credible is to say, well, both these political parties are becoming more and blah, blah, blah. It's really very much on one side. There's a book written by a couple of guys at Yale called Off Center, where they do a very elaborate statistical analysis showing that the American people have pretty much stayed where they were for the last 40 years. They're very much in the middle. The Democratic Party has actually moved a little toward the middle. And that's my experience and sense of the people that I know who serve in Congress as Democrats. I think that's right. But the Republican Party has moved very much to the right, and I think disturbingly they have also really stopped competing for the middle in a lot of ways, at least ideologically. And I'd say you don't have to buy the book. You can look at Dick Nixon sent a health care message to Congress in 1973. It was a program that was far beyond what either the House and Senate are talking about today. And he sent a message with that was to the left of anything that Nancy Pelosi's saying. In that era, he was not seen as a moderate Republican because you had guys like Mark Hatfield or Chuck Percy or Jake Javits or Ed Brooke, or there are probably 10 other senators who were substantially to the left. All of those people are gone. That is not, that type of mentality is not allowed in the party anymore. And people that can go to the table and take revenues as like, we got to solve this problem. You guys got to give up something. We're going to give up something. You can't do that. There's a litmus test in that party. They cannot go to the table and play that game. They are funded by people who absolutely prohibit they're moving in that direction. And I think George Herbert Walker Bush is the last example of someone who tried that and found out it couldn't happen.
Bill?
I agree with Scott on his analysis. But in terms of the crisis, who knows? But my sense here is that the day that our foreign investors stop buying our bonds, when China stops and we have to pay, interest rates start heading back up to levels that we saw there in the late 70s and 80s, when we start finding out that to pay the piper it's going to cost, I think that will focus the attention of the American public and the politicians. Now, there are better economists in this room than me who could argue that, you know, China is kind of in this with us a little bit, and they can't quite just withdraw by themselves. But to me, that we now, in the 30-some years I worked on the budget, the thing that's impressed me the most, has changed the most, is the way we finance. Never worried about the flow of funds and where the revenues and where the purchasers were coming from. But now I think we have to look in a global sense, and I think we're going to find out that this globalization has its benefits, but it also could have its could really risk. And I worry about the day that we can't we have to start paying a heavy interest rate for the money that we borrow, and that will be a crisis, and the dollar will shrink.
Eric, any thoughts?
I sort of subscribe to Scott's analysis of the decline of the centrist, moderate Republican and the sort of radical movement of the Republican Party. But I also think that, the Obama administration deserves some blame, too, for miscalculation and blowing some huge political opportunities last year. And there were a lot, with the obsession with health care reform, something that's dominated the Congress for well over a year, has basically moved a lot of other important things off the table. And I think that Republicans sensed an opening. They saw a weakness and they moved in, and their feeling now is why should we cooperate? It's not in our best interest. Things are moving in our direction. So I think there's, as they always say, there's plenty of blame to go around, but I think the administration has got to do some soul searching about its tactics in the first year.
The public, from the public's perspective, I don't think you're going to see the public really lock on to the deficit in the same way that maybe they did in the 90s until the employment picture looks a little better. Right now, it's such a dominant issue. I mean, as long as there's 9.7%, 10% unemployment, that will be the dominant economic issue. And I don't think there's any way you can connect the dots between the deficit and the pain that people are feeling out there. I mean, with jobs the number one issue, again, the deficit becomes something of an abstraction. Now, if, as Bill says, you see this higher interest rates, which is the classic way, I think, that the public feels the impact of deficit, then you'll see it come up even more on the agenda as it is. I think it's pretty impressive, though, that it shows up at 11% in our poll is the most important problem, given the fact that jobs are so overwhelming as an issue right now.
Will the new commission that's just being formed make any difference in the national conversation? I get the impression from what some of you have said that you don't even have much hope that it'll come to any agreement, but given the membership and the way the parties are going now, but will its recommendations have any kind of impact on what might go forward from there in terms of, let's say, the president's next budget and how Congress might act, or will that just really not have any kind of influence at all?
First, it'd be nice to know who the Speaker Pelosi is going to appoint. I don't think she's appointed anybody.
She's not.
She's not. Yeah. Which I don't know what signal that sends either. But I mean, we had an opportunity. There was an opportunity there in the Senate, as you pointed out in your paper, Don. There was an opportunity to do this in the real way, which was to force it through. I'm not always wild about these commissions, but there was an opportunity, and they dropped the balls. So I'm not sure that. I can't say for certain, but I guess my inclination here is, without a forcing event, and at least looking at, with all due respect to some of the members that have been appointed, particularly on the Republican side, it's going to be hard, it seems to me, to get three of them to agree, three of those on the Republican side to agree to what has to be part of this solution, and that's taxes as well as spending. But if all it is spending, which then I don't think it has any chance at all.
Didn't the president have something in his executive order of a supermajority requirement for any agreement or any recommendation to go forward? Or I believe he did, but I'm not sure of that.
I think Alan Simpson's a great guy, but I don't know how many votes he brings in the Senate. And
or Erskine Bowles, for that matter.
I mean, that's true.
And I think Bill's right. It's got to involve revenues, and I think that is not going to happen in the Congress, regardless of who's on the commission or how much support there is. They're not going to go there. So I don't think I think the one thing it does is people think when there's not an agreement, it's the fault of the White House, and if you have a commission, it's the fault of the commission rather than the White House, and so it does serve a useful purpose, but not in terms of getting an agreement on the budget deficit.
Okay, just one last point that nobody knows. We're still, six or so many months out from the midterm election, but I'm curious as to what if one of the chambers flipped in November, how that would impact upon any recommendations from this commission. I have the gut sense that it would work even further against accepting a commission that was set up under this.
For those of you who are not familiar, the commission does not have to report until after the midterm election, so that was, I guess, to insulate a bit their ability to put something forward to the Congress that might be voted on at least early in the next Congress, but we'll see if they can even get to that point. Let's turn to questions from our audience. Please wait for the microphone and give your name and affiliation. Let's start over here with Sonia.
Hi, thank you. Sonia Michelle, Director of U.S. Studies here at the Wilson Center. This is a very interesting discussion, and it's really complicated because it operates on so many different levels. But let me just pick up from this last topic about this commission. I've been thinking about this commission myself because I'm a historian, and I'm a historian of social policy, and I'm also been listening to a lot of the progressive organizations around town rail against the commission, both in Congress and then now with the the formation of it under the executive order. And what struck me as really interesting is that the conservatives and the progressives actually allied in their opposition to the commission. And I'm for very different reasons, but they agreed. And I think they're just as unhappy. I'm hearing lots of progressive voices, and I think they're just as unhappy with the executive formed commission as they would have been with a congressional one. They're particularly upset about the appointment of Alan Simpson. What the question is, I mean, if we're going to talk about this as the deficit as in terms of public opinion, I was struck by what Carol Dougherty said about how as long as unemployment remains high, the deficit is going to be secondary. But it seems to me that from the perspective of advocates for various kinds of social policy, particularly preserving Social Security, not even Social Security reform, but just preserving it, it seems like the deficit is this kind of black box and that it's just used as a bludgeon against Social Security or against the idea of preserving Social Security. In other words, there's a hierarchy. So the deficit's up here, then unemployment's up here, then the deficit, and then things like health care reform even or preserving Social Security and so forth. In other words, it's to switch metaphors, it's a political football. And it just seems to me that it gets invoked by various parties at different times in ways that can be quite obstreperous and unconstructive in terms of having this real debate about, okay, if we do need to make some cuts, how can we do it? In other words, sort of asking the question about what kind of crisis do we need to get something to happen seems even more problematic, because then it seems like it's going to be very even more difficult to think clearly about how to make cuts if we're in crisis mode. So I don't know. I just wonder if you could enlighten me a little bit about how your take on how the deficit gets used in these different ways and whether it can be used constructively or whether it's always going to be kind of a bludgeon. I guess that's
I mean, one of the things you see looking over the historical data of public opinion is it when a party's on the outs of government, its members suddenly get a great deal, they become much more concerned about deficits than when their party was in power. it's a very interesting pattern we've seen over time that in fact Republicans through the 90s were the deficit hawks, and we saw a little bit of that among Democrats in the last decade, and now we're starting to see the switch occur again, and it is very interesting. But I think just from the public's perspective, I do think Bill's right that you need this crisis. You need a demonstration effect for the public before it grapples with the seriousness. You can talk until you're blue in the face about commissions and everything else, but until they feel it, until people feel it in their everyday lives, they're feeling the unemployment problem right now. I mean, we have a poll in the field now. We're getting preliminary data. It is extraordinary the pain that people are feeling out there. I mean, these are people with incomes of $75,000 a year and more who are experiencing some sort of job stress, either a foregone raise, maybe a child moving back home because they can't find a job. I mean, that is until this situation works itself out. I think in some ways it's analogous to the early 80s, because then, as we all know, in Reagan's first year, that was the situation as well, when soaring unemployment up to past 10% at one point in 1982, and in fact had an effect on his job ratings, and it wasn't until much later that that the deficit became an issue.
I think I can remember when I, for a decade or more after I was on the Hill, maybe two decades, and Bill was there, and I think he would recall the same thing. I mean, when the deficit really did, I think the deficit has been used as an issue in many, many instances when it wasn't. I mean, it was a red-hot issue in 1973 and 1974, and if you remember my chart up there, that was when we got the public debt to 73.9% of GDP. We have never in a century been at as good a point in terms of the public debt as we were at the time we passed the Budget Act, and it went to hell after that, I think you might say. But there was a period when we did have serious problems, we could get sensible people to sit down in a room and work things out. That was, I think, for two reasons that don't exist today. One is the shift in party alignment, And when you have a party that does not address the middle, it's more about how you talk about a problem than what you do about it. You redefine the problem so it's somebody else's. You have Fox News to help you out on that. You have all kinds of megaphones that you can use to distort the problem rather than to address it. And I think that's greatly exacerbated by what Eric talked about in terms of, I remember when Walter Cronkite would go on in the evening and everybody in America would sit there and say, yeah, that's what informed people
it
think.
Is.
Yeah, and that was maybe a little naive. But now, you know, people distrust the news because the news is that you watch MSNBC or you watch Fox and you got all of these people that are off on one tirade or another, and there is no really center or balanced, informed middle that does a serious job of trying to interpret the events of the day.
Anyone else? Eric?
I don't think I can add to that.
All right. Other questions? Let's bring the microphone up here, and then we'll get the woman on the inside.
Monty Tripp with Wexler and Walker. As we talk about entitlements and recognize that retirement and health care are the growing costs, and looking at the health care bill that will likely be passed this week, how do we compare the cost of that to the, I guess, uncaptured costs of health care right now? We have so many people who are using the system, I guess, through emergency services or other ways that don't seem to be captured in the current budget. What's the difference?
You go ahead.
Well, this has been a huge fight between advocates of health reform and the CBO. And there is, I think there's a considerable body of thought that the only way you can rationalize the system is to bring everybody into coverage, have them start paying their fair share or be tied up. And that way, providers aren't having to give kind of unknown amounts of charity to, you know, unspecified numbers of people that aren't covered. And you then can really start looking at how much people are paying, and people begin to pay for their own rather than for somebody else's through a system that can't do it. So I think that there is a great deal of benefit to this bill, and I do think it will bend the cost curve, and it will furthermore set up a playing field where you can evaluate where the costs are much more accurately than you can under the current system and start squeezing back the excesses and the irrationalities in the system. So I think it's there. I think there are savings to be made. They're not being scored by CBO at this point, and so there are people that have judgments that they don't save. It doesn't bend the curve. I believe it does.
Bill, which hat do you want to wear?
Well, let me put the budget hat on first. Monty, from my perspective, the uncompensated care that's out there, there is uncompensated care. But that uncompensated care gets passed on back, quite frankly, to the private sector. And you're paying for it one way or the other. There's some compensation, I guess, for hospitals. What's the particular term I'm looking for is the high-risk hospitals that receive special payments. But those payments were going away in this bill because the assumption is, as Scott has said, that everybody will be covered. And let me just put the private sector hat on for a second here. No question in my mind that the solution, the president's right on this. In terms of, if you want to try to approach this problem, everybody should be in the system. That's what insurance is all about. There shouldn't be people out there selectively deciding to come into the insurance to get their insurance when their house is on fire. They should be in it from the beginning. And I'm all for individual mandates. I'm all for guaranteed issue, no pre-existing conditions. But the problems, as I see it, Scott, is that this bill doesn't really force that individual to get in there too quickly. Also, I think while there are a number of pilot studies, mm-hmm. when I am piloted out, when do we stop pilot testing in this country and move on to actually implementing modification in the fee-for-service on the basis of product produced as opposed to the number of services provided. So my sense here is there are good things in this bill. I'm not as optimistic as Scott that, quote, it will bend the cost curve. I think where I am putting my budget hat back on, which I think is confusing to the American public, and it's a terribly difficult issue, and that is that we're talking about total national health care expenditure versus the federal government's expenditures. And what I see here is that we can talk about this is going to reduce the deficit. Well, you can raise taxes, you can tax, and you can reduce the deficit in this bill. But if all you're doing is pushing it on out so that it ends up back out on the private sector and you're not bending total national health care expenditures, I don't think you're going to be successful in the long run. There is a way to control costs. It's called capitation. Boy, it is. There's a way to do this, and I don't think the American public want to go there.
Why don't you explain briefly what capitation is?
Bottom line would be that we will set the prices. Government will set the prices, and that's it, both for the private and for the public sector. And we're going to cap. We're going to make that's it, and that's what we're going to pay. And it's basically price controls. That has an effect of having some rationing on what's provided out there. But there is a way to control cost, and that is to fix them. And I just don't think we're there yet.
This young lady had her hand up first, and then we'll go to John Kingdon, and then to the woman back there.
Go over here.
Hi, how are you doing? Hi. My name is Shannon. I'm with LaRouche Pack. And my first question, I have two questions quickly. The first one is regarding Alexander Hamilton. And I was just wondering why none of you discussed him and the way that he dealt with debt. Now, I know none of your graphs went back to the 1780s or so, but there was a huge debt crisis from the Revolutionary War, which he dealt with through the creation of a national bank. So I wanted you to just comment on that. And then the second question is about Obama and his increasingly, I guess, unpopularity. This is perhaps highlighted best by a Democratic candidate in Texas who just won a primary calling for his impeachment, in part based on his policy of making cuts. So I was wondering if you were going to do any polls regarding the percentage of the population that agrees with that call, and if you think that Obama will have any reactions to that, maybe even resigning and making way for an Alexander Hamilton-type policy.
Well... we're a little away from that, I think. We haven't asked an impeachment question. Let's see, Eric, in about 12 years ago, was it? Mm-hmm. I think we used to ask quite a few impeachment questions. To be serious, not to tout our polls too much, but we will be out this week with a new poll on politics and healthcare, and it'll probably maybe be the last House passage measure on the health care bill. I suspect not much will change from where we had it in February, which is more disapproval than approval. On Obama, you know, I think if you want to see where Obama's been and where he's going, look at Ronald Reagan's approval chart in his first year and a half, 2 years of his presidency, and you see a lot of similarities there. He's hanging in there at around 50% or a little bit below in most polls, and his disapproval is rising a little bit. But certainly, there's not been a plunge in his overall standing among the public. In fact, it's been, you know, despite what you may read on the Drudge Report and other sources, it's been fairly steady over the last several months. As has been views of healthcare, despite what you may read or hear.
I was just reading about Alexander Hamilton the other day, and one of the things they did to try and get rid of the national debt was the whiskey tax, and they ended up with a little whiskey rebellion up in Pennsylvania where George Washington had to lead the troops up there to put them down because the small producers of the corn whiskey were getting a higher taxation rate than the big producers. But in any event...
war with unappropriated money.
Yeah. Anybody else on this? Let's go to John Kingdon.
I'm John Kingdon from the University of Michigan. You don't look at budgets, the federal budget at least, too long before you realize that the big problem is health. That Alice Rivlin and I wrote a little piece a while ago that argued that we could deal with the Social Security issue. That with a little tweaking and a little bending on all sides, we could handle Social Security. And discretionary spending is not where the big money is either. And so you're left with health. And that means Medicare, Medicaid, and whatever new we do. For shorthand purposes, let's call it Obamacare. And if you take seriously the cutting the spending side on health, well, there's some things that can be done. Electronic medical records and coordination of care and best practices. But Bill Hoagland is right. The big thing is an attack on fee-for-service. And you do that either by putting providers on salary or through capitation. And I don't know how else you do that. which means we're not going to get a lot on the spending side when it comes to health, which means that we have to look at revenues. I think that one of the more interesting ideas is to create a new healthcare trust fund, which would roll Medicare, Medicaid, and Obamacare into it and finance it with a consumption tax, probably a nationwide value-added tax. But in order to actually get that done, voters are going to have to grow up, if I can put it that way. My wife's Norwegian, and they have very high taxes in Norway, and they don't like them any more than we like high taxes. But they're grown up about it. They know that they're getting government benefits, and they're willing to pay. And it's going to take a real sort of leadership that emerges to convince the American public that we can't keep going this way. Now, the reason that the healthcare trust fund is politically kind of nice is that polls have shown for many years that one thing that people are willing to be taxed more for is healthcare. And so it can be portrayed in the, and it's not just portrayed, it would be a way to pay for Medicare. This is the way we're going to save Medicare. We're going to create this healthcare trust fund. But I must say I share Scott Lilly's and Bill Hoagland's pessimism about it. I don't see the leadership emerging, and I don't see this change in public opinion emerging, and both of them are required, and I'm deeply pessimistic.
Well, a couple things come to mind. As long as I've been covering the budget or been around Congress, people have been talking about a VAT tax. And, going back to when Dan Rostenkowski was Ways and Means, and before that.
You're talking about value-added tax.
Value-added tax, sort of a European-style sales tax implemented at various levels. Right. And it seems like, and even Nancy Pelosi mentioned it not too long ago. I just think it's a non-starter. I mean, I just don't think it's going to happen. And secondarily, I just think that there are, in terms of trying to rein in healthcare costs, there's so much regional tension and rivalry and competition among the hospitals and their advocates in Congress, especially among the blue dog Democrats, conservative Democrats from smaller rural areas in the South and Midwest, who feel strongly that their hospitals are getting a raw deal in terms of reimbursement formulas and all that. It's such a political mess, really, in terms of trying to work through anything in Congress in a comprehensive way that I just think that, the conflict between the insurers and the hospitals and the regional rivalries makes it very difficult to come to terms and come to agreement on some major reduction in Medicare over the long term.
I like your proposal, John. I would expand upon it just a little bit, though, and that is that it's not just the federal government, as you know, particularly on Medicaid. And if there's a way you could bring the states into your trust fund or your health fund, you take the burden off the states, particularly on the long term. Maybe you could develop some more support out there for this kind of approach, because now you've got the states with their skin in the game to what Virginia just cut Medicaid last night 4% or 5% in terms of their mm-hmm. benefits. So I think you're getting, but more to your point, not necessarily do I espouse this outcome, but I would predict that if you are going to do anything about these projected deficits we put up here, assumed that the president's health care reform of what was on the Hill would pass, and yet you still had to put a commission in place to get down to even 3% of GDP. So I guess, whether my conservative friends will hate me for saying this, I don't think there will be any alternative but a VAT tax if you're going to change this, because you're not going to go back and revisit cuts in Medicare after you've gone through, as the Republicans up there made such a big deal out of, cutting Medicare. So I think you may get to what you're talking about indirectly over time.
Yeah, I would say the health care is not just the central issue of the federal government. It really is, if you look across the growth of discretionary spending and Social Security and all the other entitlements, and then look at where it's coming from. It's coming from health care. But it's not just the federal government. I mean, it's the problem that we have with General Motors. It's a problem that we have with American manufacturing across the board. And even, at the state level, we're going to have, I guess, a major overhaul of higher education funding in the reconciliation bill. And what is really happening with higher education funding is the state governments, in order to pay Medicaid costs, are pulling back on colleges and universities, forcing up tuition costs, and the federal government is then coming back in trying to make up a portion of that. In the process, state universities are really becoming out of the reach of middle-class families. So you've got health care eating away at every institution in the country in a way that's is very pernicious. I think I'm going to disagree with Eric on this. I think the VAT is a possibility for some compromise, and I can see some of the libertarians in the Republican parties who would not go for any other kind of revenue, who would say, well, this might be a way of moving away from the income tax, not just in terms of anything that might happen with health care, but more generally, and it would be an opening there. So you might be able to get them down. But so far, nothing. There has not been. I mean, I think that's been surfaced. CAP surfaced, Center for American Progress surfaced a proposal 4 years ago to pay for health care reform with a VAT tax. And we've worked to try to get a dialogue going, and no one will talk about it on the other side. So.
Okay. Woman in the back there.
Hi, I'm Allison Frazier from Heritage, one of the libertarian conservatives. my question, I guess, is sort of a long, rambling one. I've done a lot of work over the years talking about this very issue, and it's nice to be on the other side of the panelists who are giving really depressing information. I am very chagrined about, I guess, your sort of consensus that it is really going to take some sort of crisis before Congress will truly be able to come together and deal with this. And I guess, looking at the last slide that you have up there, revenues have to be on the table. I guess from my perspective, revenues have to be on the table and spending cuts have to be on the table, because without that kind of dynamic, you're kind of looking at sort of nuclear disarmament. One side's not going to go first without the other side. So, in thinking, how do we really foster this kind of productive conversation? It's just been totally lacking in the serious political dialogue, anyway, that's going on. And one of the things that I think doesn't show up in all the polling that you've been talking about is the work that, Joe and me and others on the Fiscal Wake Up Tour have been doing, which is to go out and engage audiences in a real right, left, center kind of way, where we're not fighting about the facts. We're giving all the same charts that you guys have all given and talking about what all the options are. And you know, the public is ready to engage in this. They just want to be talked to in a very serious, frank way without all the, you know, very vitriolic partisan rhetoric. And they're ready to talk about really, really tough things. And so I guess the question to the panel is, do you think that there, after the election and after health care, that there will be a way to seriously move forward with this kind of discussion about, you know, what these options are? So, you know, if it's a VAT, if it's supply-side tax reform, if there's other kinds of things on the spending side, how do we engage Americans pre- the big crisis to get better conversation and policy options on the table?
I appreciate your optimism, and I had it one time when I came in this town, and I'd like to think, yes, that after, quote, the midterm elections, what concerns me is there's always another election, and that next election is a presidential election. And I would say, and I'm not trying to be partisan here, I'm just trying to say that it is the, if the president, with that power that he has, will do what you said, let's have a frank, open discussion about this. I hate to do this, Eric, but you said you can't make the front page. I just happened to go through my notes last night. The Washington Post, a year ago, Obama pledges entitlement reform. Front page, up front. If he would get back on where he was when he got elected, and he's willing to do that now knowing that he faces the electorate now in the next cycle, then I think there's hope. I guess I'm a little, I'm not sure about that right now. The leadership at both ends of Pennsylvania Avenue and both parties has not been there.
Let's go to, do you want to make a
comment? Yeah, I just, you know, I'm willing to be quite critical of this president and for many things. I think Eric had a valid point when he said that he lost a lot of opportunities to move on to more important issues. But I do think that he is open to having a fair discussion. I don't think there's a chance in the world. I think the opposition party, and you live in a country that has two parties. You're going to have two good parties or you're going to have two bad parties. If one party decides they're going to play it in a very partisan, ugly kind of way, that's what's going to happen. And I think that's the world we live in. And if we have a crisis, if the Japanese or the Chinese start shifting out of treasuries into something else, I basically don't think that's going to happen. I think the more insidious outcome is that they're going to continue to nurse us along as we fall apart. But if we have a really ugly crisis, I think people will be fighting over how they characterize it rather than figuring out how to fix it. And I just don't see anybody giving up from going down that road. And I don't think the election's going to make any difference. And we have to figure out why that is and how we change the body politic before we can begin to address not just budget issues, but issues generally.
I also think that, 6 months or whatever it is an eternity in politics, and a lot's going to depend on how the campaign goes. A lot is going to depend on how the economy goes and whether we're going to see any kind of movement on unemployment, whether there's, indication that we're beginning to put the recession behind us. And I think that's going to affect a lot of thinking on whether or not there's a crisis. I think economy coming back will make a big difference in terms of, long-term deficit projections. I also think that there will be some kind a semblance of a debate on this issue in the run-up to the election, because this commission, whether or not it's going to have any real impact or not, it's got to get started sometime soon. It's going to have hearings. It's going to have people are going to have to start putting their cards on the table. So you'll get a sense of where the committee is headed. I mean, I think most of us are pretty skeptical that anything positive can come out of it. And there's, you know, the history of these commissions is that there has to be a political consensus to get anything done. You know, going back to the Greenspan Commission, everybody, you know, applauds the commission, but it was actually, you know, lawmakers sitting in a back room somewhere and cutting
a
deal.
They were facing a crisis.
They were facing a crisis. There was a real crisis. The Social Security system was in big trouble. So you need a crisis and you need a bipartisan consensus to get something done. A commission is just window dressing, and it can make recommendations or not, but unless the politicians are ready to go back to the Capitol and vote for it, it's a pretty meaningless exercise.
Let me just say that the slides that I put up and the ones that are in your handout are from the bipartisan slides that Judd Gregg and Kent Conrad put together, and they were part of the fiscal wake-up tour as well. And, you know, I think we saw a combination there of people at the top trying to work across party lines to educate folks, as well as people from the bottom up and meeting with all the various groups that you did across the country. And yet that educational effort didn't quite connect with the masses in terms of turning numbers around, but I think it really is an educational effort that has to go on and on and on, and I just want to commend you all for doing what you did. I mean, you had Heritage and which other, Concord in that, and yeah, Brookings, yeah. I thought that was just a wonderful thing, but it doesn't seem to turn the big poll numbers around at the top any, but... Do you want to say anything on that?
Well, that's right. I mean, I think a little history again, in terms of the partisan nature, not just of Washington, but of the country itself, we made a big splash recently about, you know, this was a while ago in Obama's, I guess it was last year, saying that Obama's approval ratings were the most polarized in recent history. That was a tick up from George Bush's ratings, which were a couple of ticks up from Bill Clinton's ratings, which were, you know, I mean, on and on and on, and it does keep getting worse, as we go forward. I mean, this idea of polarization. I mean, the one effect it's had, though, is that you do see party identification for both the Republicans. I mean, we saw the party identification, the percent saying they are Republican, plunging over the last few years of Bush. We now see the Democrats either holding steady or perhaps losing a little bit of ground. And what does that mean? The proportion of independents is probably greater now than it has been at any time in the last half century. That's where the potential is for some of this, kind of middle ground. I mean, as we all know, independents aren't true independents. They're not all, you know, open-minded centrists. Many of them lean Republican in a very conservative way. Some of them lean Democratic. But I do think this idea that independents are out there, they do care about the budget deficit, as a potential way to, you know, kind of break the logjam that exists.
Well, we started. Did you have Joe? Did you get the microphone? Yeah, go ahead. It'll be the last question. We started about 5 minutes late, so we'll end with this question.
Joe Minerick, Committee for Economic Development. Great session, lots of things to chew on. I just like to mention three things. Eric said that he feared that the internet was going to turn people off. I guess my greatest fear about the internet is because everybody has a soapbox and you don't have to go through an editor with gray hair who has seen it all before and who can strike some of the things you're saying. What I'm most concerned about is that anybody from any extreme ideological position can find somebody who appears to have some measure of authority to ratify your preconceptions. And as a result, what I see out of the internet, for what it's worth, it's one person's opinion, but a polarization of popular opinion, which I find very troubling. I think it's part of the reason why we can't come to any resolution here. I did want to say something to John's point from a moment ago, and if I got you right, what you said was we aren't going to get very far in solving the health care problem in cutting spending, so therefore we're going to have to get it on the revenue side. Just to make the point, which I think, just for perspective, if you don't slow the rate of growth of health care costs, which are projected for the indefinite future to grow 2 percentage points per year faster than GDP, you can't raise revenues enough to solve that problem. Eventually, it's going to get out of control, so we're going to have to do something about that. But the final point, which maybe people would like to discuss, I think it's been raised before, but maybe in a slightly different context. Leon Panetta's name has been evoked in the course of these conversations, and I heard Leon say many, many times that if you go into a bipartisan negotiation over the budget, you start out with some notion that there has got to be shared sacrifice, and you start out with the notion that you're going to get some part of what you need out of revenues and some part out of spending, and that in so doing, you create at least some sense that everybody is contributing. You can't have somebody dropping out of the deal because he says that nobody else is sacrificing, it's all coming down on me. It does seem pretty clear in the construction of this commission so far is that we have a number of appointees who seem to be going in with the premise that all of the savings have got to come on the other guy's side of the budget. And if our sense of shared sacrifice has eroded that far, I don't see how we're going to get out of this short of a crisis. And I think Bill made the point correctly. When we get to the point where we can't roll over the Treasury debt, that'll wake people up, but it's going to do so much damage in the course of it that there's got to be a way somehow to beat that.
Well, with that,
Can I?
Oh, yeah, sure. I'm sorry.
Can we just go one more minute here? And
sure.
I'd like to turn the tables just a little bit on you, Don.
Uh-oh.
As a Woodrow Wilson scholar, what would Woodrow Wilson do?
Well, he gave us the income tax to begin with. He'd probably ramp it up a bit, but thank you. What I'd like to do after is to have you join me in thanking the panel, and then join us for a wine and cheese and a little extended conversation just outside these doors. Okay.